All right, so what can we do here?
Yes, I don't know how the transition will go.
There, you're in the middle of two PC users, so I'll come in during Q. The first speaker after he wraps up, there's going to be Q&A. I'll come down there Q&A, and we'll try to do a quick transition to your laptop. But we can test it.
Yeah, let's test it.
All right, can I have everybody's attention? Well, good evening. I'm Craig Thompson. I'm the president and CEO here at Memorial Sloan Kettering. So it's my honor and privilege to welcome you to this, what is the 11th of the Major Trends in Modern Cancer Research Symposium. You come from a wide range of the schools in the greater New York area. And I'm increasingly appreciated that a number of the schools are showing up with two classes as students get excited about biology. Earlier and earlier in their academic career. That also means you have the potential to come here a couple times. So how many are here for their second time? Ah, good number. How many people are here for a third time? Oh, wow, that's cool. Well, we welcome everybody every year. So for the people who are here for the third time, you'll see a new set of faculty. I'm not sure my introduction gets all that different every third year, so for those, if I ask some questions and make some audience participation go on, they don't get the shout out. If you've been here 3 years, you've at least heard most of the things I'm going to tell you about in the beginning. We're really excited to have all of you here, and I should remind everybody that you're not the only ones in the audience here tonight. There are two other rooms where classes are gathered. They're listening by video monitor. And they can hear everything that's going on here. And that's why when you get to questions and answers for the individual faculty member who are going to present some of their research programs, please come to one of the two microphones on either side to ask your question. Because we're entering a modern era, we have a Twitter feed, a hashtag MSKMajorTrends, where you can exchange and give your thoughts ongoing as the symposium does, and everybody will be able to see that. On the feed if you want to participate now and later. The entire program today will be loaded up on the web and be available through the MSK website by the end of the week for your classmates who might, you get excited, I hope you're going to get excited about some things and want to actually share that with them. So it will be available. For those that are first timers, I do like to give a little bit of an introduction. I think this mic still works, right? You can still hear me as I walk around. It's going to be a question from your family when you go home tonight about why you learned about major trends in this part of biology and you went to a cancer hospital because that's what Memorial Sloan Kettering is known about. We are the oldest research institute and the oldest hospital dedicated to understanding the problem of cancer. It's not the only problem in biology. But we think it's a really important problem by which to discover ways in which we work as an organism, to discover fundamental principles of biology, as well as to deal with perhaps one of the most devastating diseases that human beings will face in their lifetime. Here's the latest update. Half of you in your lifetime will face a diagnosis of cancer. All of you will have a close family friend or relative or significant other who faces a diagnosis of cancer. That's a great news in some ways, because cancer is a disease of longevity, and you can expect, if you stay healthy, do the right things, to live into your 90s. And unfortunately, our cancer risk doubles with every decade of our life. So it's both good news and bad news, what I just told you. It means we all have to have some appreciation of what the illness is and what it means for us as an organism. All of you have learned in biology that there's one basic unit on which all of biology is created. It's the cell. So the first question I always start this introduction with, the number changed this year, interestingly enough. It's fun to have social media because there's debates about any of these answers. And the question that I want all of us to think about first is you just walked in here as a bunch of cells that make you up as a unique individual. How many cells did you walk in with? Anybody know? How many individual cells make up your body? All right, somebody's got to either raise their hand or shout out a number so that we all heard it so you're committed. 1 billion, I heard. 1 trillion, I've heard. 1/3 answer I clearly heard from somebody. 100 billion. So we're done. 100 trillion. Okay. All right, so we got three answers. 100 trillion, a trillion, or a billion. They're all pretty big numbers, right? There are 300 million Americans in this country. So all of the numbers you're talking about are vastly bigger than that. The smallest number is a billion. How many people think we have a billion cells we walked in here on average with? Somebody shouted it out. Somebody should have raised their hand. How many people think it was 1 trillion cells is the closest number? Pretty good number. How many people think it's 100 trillion? Oh, it's about a dead tie. Well, that's good, because the number is exactly halfway in between. Okay? The largest estimate right now is 60 trillion cells. The lower end is about 40 trillion cells. Now, to make that interesting in biology, there's a new fact. We live with about 60 trillion bacteria on our body every day. So actually, the real number for those that picked 100 million is the right answer. But it's 40 to 60 of you, trillion of you, and 60 trillion of the other guys. And we live as a complex ecosystem of the bacteria that are in our intestines and on our skin, and we're learning more and more about that, and it's critical to understand human disease, and we live with 60 trillion cells that make up a human body. The amazing thing is that all 60 trillion of those cells have exactly the same DNA. Every one of them got a copy of 3 billion bits of information from your mother and 3 billion bits of information from your dad. And they all have exactly the same DNA. It's packed into 46 chromosomes. And the average length of the chromosome in each of those cells, anybody got the average length of a human chromosome stretched end to end, the real length, not with the magnifying glass, the real length. Anybody know how big they are? 10 yards is one guess. It's not bad. A mile? Okay, so each cell, each of the 60 trillion cells you have 46 chromosomes. And if all the chromosomes were laid end to end to get to that answer, it's actually a meter. Or a little longer than a yard for each cell. A meter-long piece of information. Each chromosome is itself about 1 inch long. It's amazing that you can pack that amount of information into each of the 60 trillion cells and how you actually do it and the complexity and how you get back at that to know what genes each cell needs so that a cell in the back of your eye can see light, that a cell on your skin can block barrier and prevent this, the cells in your liver can detoxify all the things you just ate in the stack room back in the back. How do they do that is one of the fundamental mysteries we don't know as biology. So one of the problems with the classes you take, the teachers will have to turn their ears off right now, is we tell you all the answers we know. There's many, many things we don't know about biology that would help with human health, that would help us in preventing disease, that would just be fundamentally important to know as we go through life. And we don't know them. That's why biology is a fascinating aspect of things to learn about, whether you ultimately become a biologist or have an appreciation because your body's a pretty important thing to you. Why we care about cancer is because we are, among all living things in one major class, we're all part of the animal kingdom. And the animal kingdom shares one unique property that is carried out in different ways in all species. And that's the ability to repair ourselves when we're damaged. So every one of you has cut yourself in the last week, and you're expecting your skin in that cut to scab over and then heal up and be normal a couple of weeks from now. That's a unique property of animals, and we have to have that property to be able to live and hunt for food and flee from danger because we're motile organisms. And so as we stretch and we move and we bump into things, we're going to damage ourselves. As we move into different environments, we're going to breathe different things and they're going to damage our lungs. When we eat different things because we're omnivores, we're ultimately going to damage our intestine. We have to replace all the tissues in our body over. So those 60 trillion cells that you have that you came with have to be replaced in some real time. And it's a fascinating property because about 100,000 of your cells have died in the time I've been up here. And they turned over just because they're old and obsolescent, like some of your blood cells. All of your blood cells turn over every 100 days. You make your entire blood, 10 pounds worth of your body is made over every 100 days. Because they're all part of your defense system and you must constantly renew that. They're the way you carry oxygen in your blood and you must renew that. At the same time, you came in with a whole bunch of cells in your brain, you hope last 90 years without ever turning over, keeping healthy, not ever thinking about being damaged or dying, so that they can keep those memories that you hold dear with you, keep those memories of how to write and how to walk and how to find things, how to do things intact. So some cells have to live 90 years and some cells turn over literally every 2 weeks. But regeneration, making new tissues, repairing damaged tissue, is a property of all the tissues of our body. And as a result, all animals are at risk of two major types of disease, which oddly enough don't really happen in the other community of organisms that are multicellular, that have many cell types, and that's plants. Plants don't go anywhere. They don't actually bother to ever try and fix themselves. You tear a leaf off, it won't grow a new leaf until next year when the whole process goes on. You break a branch, it will stay broken for the rest of the life of that tree, even if it's 300 years. If you carve your initials in it, you can come back 60 years later and see the initials right there in the bark. Plants don't repair. They wall off damage, they make big scars, but they don't actually ever try and repair anything. And two unique properties come along with that difference between animals and plants. One we are not going to talk about today, but it's a real scary thing to your parents' generation. You've probably seen it in some of your grandparents. Human beings wear out, and so we get degenerative diseases. The ones that you read about in the press are Alzheimer's and Parkinsonism, these diseases where your brains don't make it with you to 90 years. They're more common in having your joints wear out. You see the athletes who get damaged their joints so many times they have to be replaced. And so you have a disease called osteoarthritis that affects many people once they get a little older. That's one end of the spectrum. The inability to keep maintaining the effective replacement of cells as we go through life. Those are the diseases of degeneration that are unique to all animals that exist. At the same time, the other end of the spectrum is what we're going to talk about today, and that's cancer. The abnormal accumulation of one type of cell in excess of what the organism needs. Somehow, in the process of repair, cells acquire the desire, the information, the breakage that somehow fools them into thinking their job is to make as many of themselves as they can and not to stop the process. That process we know of is cancer. The abnormal accumulation of a cell in progeny that once they damage a local organ start to metastasize and cause all the things that you've associated if you've known a friend or a family member that's had cancer. Cancer is the abnormal accumulation of cells. We now know the molecular basis. You're going to hear about that today. In many ways, the molecular basis are mutations not in the genes, not in the DNA you inherited from mom and dad, but mom and dad didn't give you a predisposition, by and large, for the vast majority of us, to cancer. But as we replace cells and we damage them and we regenerate them, somebody's got to transcribe all of those 3 billion bits of information we inherited from mom and dad, and it's hard to do in 5 minutes without making a mistake. So you're pretty used to computers. Computers are pretty good at doing things pretty fast, right? We all can deal with social media and everything. The error rate in the average computer is what? Does anybody know? The cheapest computers that you can buy at Staples and Best Buy have an error rate of between every million times they do something, they make a mistake, to every 10 million times they do something. The most effective machines that anybody has ever built have an error rate of between 10 to the minus 7th and 10 to the minus 8th, or 1 in 10 million to 1 in 100 million times. But you're copying 3 billion bits of information. You make about 30 mistakes in doing that, which makes your ability to copy, the biology in you, is tenfold better than anything man has ever created. But it's still an error rate. And unfortunately, in that error rate are what we call somatic mutations that appear in that cell. And it's those errors that we seek out in cancer research to understand why they trick a cell into thinking it should proliferate and accumulate, how it acquires properties to damage tissue and to metastasize, which is why most people die in cancer. It's a fundamentally exciting field because cancer is really 400 different diseases. It can arise in any tissue that regenerates in our body, and every tissue where there's an origin that's different, there's different genes and different causes to why that cells. And so it's all of biology that we really are trying to cover here in the Sloan Kettering Institute in terms of research. So that's why we're always disappointed that we only get to present three of the faculty member and not a whole bunch of us. There are 200 faculty members like the teachers who teach you who run research laboratories here in the institute and in the hospital trying to get at fundamental aspects of how cells replenish themselves and what goes wrong to cause and initiate cancer in that process. And so you're going to hear from three people who do fundamental research in trying to understand that process from a different perspective. Today, we're in the molecular era. That's nothing new, given the biology courses that you've heard about. And so we're going to hear from three different individuals who have gained expertise that's fundamental to our better understanding of how our bodies work and what can go wrong to cause cancer. In the first case, we're going to hear about the most common cancer that exists in males. So all the women can breathe a sigh of relief. You're not going to get this disease. It's only the guys. Okay? It's in an organ you've never really thought about. It's the prostate. The prostate has a real job. The job of the prostate is to produce a fluid that allows sperm to be stored until it's ready to do its job in reproductive tissue. So it matters to us as organisms that the prostate does its job. But as we get older, the prostate, in an evolutionary sense, has less and less of a job. And unfortunately, it's one of the most prone organisms to develop cancer in males. 70% of males have the initiation of cancer in their prostate by the time they're 70 years old. Now, the vast majority of won't die of it, but how we predict who it is and what there are is dictated by a number of important properties. And so our first speaker tonight, and I'm going to introduce him in just a second, is one of the world's experts in that process. What are the genes that go wrong specifically in that tissue as opposed to others that cause the prostate to have cancer? Second of all, what we've learned from that, and he's really pioneered, is that cancer is a much more social process than we imagined. And so one of the things he's done in the last year, I don't know if he's going to have time to tell us about, is that cancer cells are much more robust when they grow as groups. And so he's developed a technique to develop and study them in 3D culture so that they're not just single cells the way you've seen a test tube, but actually in the real structure in the gland. And we're learning fascinating things about that. I don't know how much you're going to be able to tell them about that, but it is one of the real breakthroughs in cancer biology to study the three-dimensional architecture of cancer and its complexity. What that's taught us is what the second person, Steve Long, is going to tell us about today, which is that those cells engage in communication. So when there's 10 of them, they say, I'll do that part of the problem. You, my nearest neighbor, do the other part of the problem, and let's cooperate. And that's how cancer gains a handle on the extra cells. They share this common property of being driven, and they start to specialize. And they do that by communicating between each other. And so how cells communicate, how things pass from inside the cell to outside the cell, how cells communicate the signals between them, what the language is a key part. And Steve Long is a structural biologist who works on one of the most important ways in which to communicate, which is through ion channels. And so he's going to tell you about the amazing advances and how we can study the structure of on the surface of the cells that allows cells to communicate through the exchange of molecules. And so he'll tell you about that. And then we're going to broaden it. One of the coolest new influxes of biology are really great mathematicians. Because problems when we start to talk about numbers like 6 billion, 60 trillion, are numbers we can't really logically think about. The complexity that we know about can do by sequencing the DNA that you inherited from mom and dad, but any of you, and look for the differences with cancer, is a daunting task. So it takes somebody trained both in mathematics and as well as in biology, and you're going to see one of the new vanguards of people that are studying that and really teaching us new glimpses into the complexity of the disease, cancer, and Ellie, who'll finish everything up tonight. So you're going to see three of our very best. We're going to start with Yu Chen, who's going to tell us about the prostate. The rules of the game, they're going to give you about a 20-minute. They can't possibly tell you everything they want to do, but hopefully they'll get you interested. If you're interested, get up to the mics and ask questions. We'll have about 10 minutes for questions and answers. We do need to get you guys out at 7:30. And if you're really interested, their emails will be available. We let them flood them with questions. And then I remind you on your way out, there are high school programs for people that want to engage in our research program. And each of them have hosted high school students in the past. There's an opportunity, if you're interested, to explore that after this session is over. So with that, I'm going to introduce Dr. Yu Chen. He's a member of our HOP program. I'll get out of here 1 second. Yu is both a physician who takes care of cancer patients in the hospital, as well as a researcher who runs one of our major research labs. Yu, you're on.
All right, thank you. Thank you for that great introduction. It's really a pleasure for me to come and talk to you. As Craig said, I'm a physician scientist, and actually so is Craig. And that means that I see patients with prostate cancer, and in the lab, I study prostate cancer, and I'm always mindful of the questions I have from the patients that bring me back to the lab. Now, I say I'm a physician scientist, but I don't think that word will apply that much anymore in the future, because I think all oncologists in the future will be physician scientists. In fact, whenever we see each patient, we think of them in a scientific way. Is this patient going to respond? What about the genetics of this patient that makes him or her more likely to respond or not? And in fact, we're essentially doing a scientific experiment every time we give them a drug because we don't know what's going to happen. Now, Craig is giving an amazing introduction to what I was going to talk about. The title of my talk has actually changed because they asked me for a title about 4 months ago. I was thinking, you know, we give a lot of talks. I was going to talk about things that I do in my lab. But then I was thinking, you know, high school student, what I was doing when I was in high school. I was really into soccer, and I was into math and physics. And for this, actually, you know, my daughter went trick-or-treating. And just, you know, so if you're in Harry Potter, actually, wear her tie. This is a Ravenclaw. Hi. So, you know, I want something to really, I want you to get excited about what I do. I want to portray, let you know how excited I am about what I do in lab, about seeing my patients, and working with all the colleagues. So also really highlight the things that is going on with my colleagues. So as Craig really pointed out, you know, what are the big questions, and this is part of what I'll address, and I go to prostate cancer and that, but you know, what, as soon as people start treating cancer, as soon as we as therapy, the first thing we noticed was that every cancer type is different. As Craig said, there's about 400 cancer types. They grow at different rates. As he said, some prostate cancers essentially don't grow at all. They metastasize to different places. They cause different symptoms, and they respond very differently to therapy. So in the 50s, when we had chemotherapy, we thought we're going to cure everybody until we found out that a lot of them don't respond. They respond differently. And now, what we'll see is that cancer is a very different mutational spectrum. So what is the basis of why is every cancer different? There's probably a lot of answers to that. But Craig gave a really, I think, one of the best introductions in the way we think about it. And that is, you know, every tissue is different. As he said, every tissue expresses different genes. Our melanocytes are there to pigment, our prostates there to make the seminal fluid. They respond to different stimuli. They generate different stimuli. So it's very important they respond to different stimuli. So for example, if you were to have a viral infection, you want the same stimuli that causes your immune cells to grow as to cause the infected cells to die. So the same, you know, every cell has a different set of stimuli that will cause it to grow. And so why are these cells different? And this was speculated a long time ago with this landscape. This is called an epigenetic landscape, where you start with the fertilized egg, which is labeled here as a pluripotent cell, and then they slowly differentiate down different ways. So for example, you know, go through a cell that could go both become a liver or pancreas. Two cells are somewhat similar, or a blood cell, neutrophil or lymphocyte. And then once they get there, they're a little bit trapped, but now we're learning they're not so trapped, they can change. But this is the setting that we think that cancer develops. So one of the key things that we've learned really for a long time, but over the past 10 to 20 years, is that the signals that cause a tissue to grow is often the signals that are mutated in that type of cancer. So there's a pathway, very important pathway, called the Wnt pathway that was discovered by Harold Varmus, who was Craig's predecessor here, and he won the Nobel Prize partly for this discovery. And what we know is that in the intestines, the Wnt pathway is critical for the intestines to grow and for its homeostasis. So if you have no Wnt, the intestines goes away. And in intestinal cancer, so colorectal cancer, the second most common cause of cancer death in the US, they invariably have mutations that activate the Wnt pathway. One of the common genes you might hear is called APC that causes stabilization and activation of it. And theoretically, if you were able to be able to drug this, you'll be able to really target this cancer. Unfortunately, because our intestines depend on it, if you were to drug it in every cell, your intestines will also fall apart. So this is something that is one of the, you know, how to drug this is a question that is open for you guys, the next generation, and for us to really work on. So, you know, I'm going to go through about four or five examples, and this is where you can, you know, the didactic part of the talk, where you can write notes about it. So, you know, the cerebellum has an incredible growth after you're born, when you're a kid, and this growth is mediated by a pathway called a Hedgehog pathway, also a developmental pathway. Actually, it was discovered by my freshman college biology professor, Eric Weishaus, who also won the Nobel Prize for this. And this pathway stimulates the cerebellar cells to grow, but very few other cells to grow. So there's a cancer of the cerebellum that kids develop when this goes awry. It's called medulloblastoma. It's devastating. So and it's due to mutation of this pathway. And you can see in these MRIs that the arrows point to where the cancer is. And now we have a drug that specifically inhibits this pathway, and it is somewhat tolerable. So we have seen that if you were to inhibit this pathway in this specific disease, as you can see where arrows point to, they have significantly shrunk. So you know, another disease that's very dear to my heart is another cancer type. It's a cancer type of the intestine, but not of the cells that absorb or secrete, but of the muscle layer of the intestine. It drives the contractility of the intestine. The cancer is called gastrointestinal stromal tumor. It's one of the most common sarcomas. And it's from these cells that's highlighted in brown. They're called interstitial cells of Cajal. And they need a pathway of a signal that was also developed that's discovered by somebody at Memorial Sloan Kettering, Peter Besmer, and that's of a signal called KIT. So essentially, in all patients who get this cancer too, the mutation is in KIT. It activates it. This was one of the first. This is the first signal that can be drugged and inhibited, called imatinib. You might have heard of this from work in leukemia. And you can see this patient with this huge cancer in the pelvis, essentially. Went away with KIT. Another cancer or semi-cancer that people have is that they have extra red cells, so extra red blood cells, too many red blood cells, too many platelets. And these people get horrible symptoms. So if you were to think, well, what makes red blood cells? What causes your body to make red blood cells? What causes your body to make platelets? You might think of something people, it's called EPO. You know, this is what Lance Armstrong did to help him win the Tour de France, to give him more red cells, right? So it turns out that the red blood cells goes through a receptor that is activated by epigen, and it goes through a kinase or a signaling molecule called JAK2. And Ross Levine, who is here, discovered that JAK2 is the mutation, is a molecule that is mutated in these diseases combined myeloproliferative diseases that cause excess red blood cells, excess platelets. And an inhibitor was very rapidly produced, and patients on the left who got the inhibitor versus on the blue right who got a placebo, you can see that most of them felt a lot better. This is called waterfall plot. Each line is a patient, and whether it goes up or down is whether they felt better or not. So as a final example before I give you a case about prostate cancer, B lymphocytes is a very common disease where you get cancer, and they're called B-cell lymphoma. And what we've learned so far is that the normal signaling that activates a cell can be activated, mutationally activated, and we can treat it. But what if, even if that's not mutationally activated, the cell still depends on that signaling? So it's still in that lineage, does it still depend on the same signaling molecules to survive, even if it's other mutations that cause the cancer? So are there something that B lymphocytes specifically depend on? Is there a signal that B lymphocytes specifically depend on? When I was in medical school, I learned about this disease. It's called X-linked agammaglobulinemia globulinemia. It's a disease. Struggling with that word. It's an immunodeficient disease where people don't make any antibodies. You know, B cells make antibodies. And these patients do not have B cells. They don't make antibodies. And later it was discovered that it's X-linked because there's a mutation, a loss of function in a gene on the X chromosome that causes other B cells to die. And this is a druggable gene because it's also in this family called kinases. It actually signals down the antibody pathway where the B cell sees antibody and then proliferates. And if this gene is not there, the B cell cannot signal down the antibody. So if there's a drug that targets this, you know, how does it work in lymphoma? And it amazingly does. And this is the curve in which, you know, how long does it take for the disease to progress? There's a drug called ibrutinib, and you can see the patients that were on that drug compared to chemotherapy essentially do not progress. So far I've given you examples where, you know, I think one of the major reasons that cancers are different and why they have different mutations is because of their lineage. So what about prostate cancer? So I see prostate cancer in the clinic, and I'm going to skip this from a great introduction from Craig. He's for time. I'm going to spend the rest of my talk on a patient that I started seeing about 4 years ago. This patient, SC, when I saw him first, he had disease that went all throughout the bone. So bone is a place where prostate cancer tends to metastasize. In the blood, he had something called a PSA, which is, I'll talk to you a little bit about later, but it's very high. Normal is less than 4. His PSA was 780. And this is a scan. It's called a bone scan. Basically, it lights up wherever prostate cancer is. In fact, this is just like an X-ray of the bone. The prostate cancer is everywhere in the bone. So how do we treat this? And, you know, is this like prostate? Well, one of the hints is that, you know, what is PSA? PSA is one of the enzymes that's in seminal fluid. And the reason it is there is because it is important for normal prostate function. It is so specific for prostate that essentially, if you don't have a prostate, your PSA is zero. So prostate is only cells that actually make PSA in your whole body. And what you can see is on the left, you have normal prostate, and they light up brightly with PSA. Again, this bronze stain is against the PSA protein. And if you look at prostate cancer, it's also bright for PSA. So it tells you prostate cancer, just like in many other cancers, is acting in many ways like the normal prostate. So can we find things that's important for normal prostate cells to survive? And is that something that we can use to target prostate cancer? Well, it just happens that prostate cancer is one of the first diseases where we have a treatment and where it was actually targeted and drugged. So this is Charles Huggins. He was a urologist at University of Chicago. And for his research, he studied dogs. And he studied the prostate in dogs and the secretion, prosthetic secretion from dogs. And what he found was that testosterone, so the male enzyme, is very important both for the survival of the prostate gland and also the secretion of all the ingredients in the prostate fluid. So if you were to castrate a dog, the prostate shrinks and the secretion goes away within a day. So he hypothesized that patients with prostate cancer might benefit from castration and getting rid of testosterone. So in 1941, he castrated 21 patients who had prostate cancer, exactly like the gentleman that I showed you, who are in pain, who are symptomatic. And he published these two papers. And what he found was that every one of them walked out of the hospital. The pain went away, and they got better immediately. So this really highlights that, you know, this is a targeted therapy. So 1941, first targeted therapy in cancer, predates chemotherapy, and highlights the importance of lineage in cancer. So I just wanted to quickly go through, not in great detail, you know, how does testosterone work? So testosterone is a signaling molecule. It's a signaling molecule that goes right through the membrane of the cell and activates a gene called the androgen receptor, which is a transcription factor. So the androgen receptor, when it binds testosterone, it goes to your nucleus, binds DNA, and activates genes such as PSA, and genes important for survival and growth. So what happened to our patient? So here we started. Nowadays, we call it ADT, androgen deprivation therapy, which is essentially castration. And you can see the immediate drop of his PSA. He felt better right away. He was back to normal. Every one of these small lines is a month. But you know, within about 6 or 7 months, his PSA started going up again. And the question is, you know, what is happening with him? This did not cure him. And in fact, when Charles Huggins won his Nobel Prize in 1966, he said that of the 21 patients that he treated, only 4 of them survived 12 years. And all the rest of them, by 20 years out, had died of the disease. So there is a real hint here, though, because you know, is androgen receptor still important? Is testosterone still important? And the hint here is that, well, the PSA is going up. As I showed you, the PSA is regulated by androgen receptor, and nothing else really can drive its expression. So the PSA is going up. It really tells you, actually, that androgen receptor is now reactivated. There's data from a lot of people that gives us mechanisms of how it happens. But you know, about 10 years ago, a new drug was developed for prostate cancer. So what androgen deprivation therapy does is keeps the testis from making testosterone. However, we have testosterone from multiple other sources. Our adrenal glands make testosterone. That's why women have testosterone. In fact, all estrogens come from testosterone. So you know, you have to have testosterone. And most of the rest of testosterone is from the adrenal glands. So a drug that was discovered, its name was abiraterone. Instead of just shutting down the testis, it actually inhibits the enzyme that makes testosterone, such that the patient's testosterone go from, so you know, in absolute terms, you know, all the boys out there may have a testosterone of 500. If you take off, give them androgen deprivation therapy, it goes down to 50. If you give them this drug, it goes down to 0. So what happened in patients in large phase 3 trial that got this drug who were resistant to androgen deprivation therapy? You can see the decline in testosterone and a significant decline in most of them. So we gave my patient this drug at this time. And this is what happened to his PSA. You can see he had a really marked, prolonged response. But about 3 years out, his PSA started to go up again. So what do we do then? Is this still a cancer that depends on androgen signaling and depends on testosterone? Well, again, there's a hint here. And the hint is the PSA is going up, right? So the PSA is going up, and we think that it might continue to depend on testosterone. So at the same time, one of our distinguished faculty, Charles Sawyers, discovered another drug to hit this. So you can either decrease the testosterone in the blood, or you can make a mimic of testosterone such that it could bind the androgen receptor, but doesn't activate it. And the drug was called enzalutamide, the red there. So while androgen, when it binds the androgen receptor, causes it to bind DNA and activate it, enzalutamide is a decoy, binds the androgen receptor, but it can't be activated. And in a similar trial, what you see is that, again, these amazing responses. So we gave this to my patient. And then he again had a response. But then as he was responding, the testosterone stayed low, he was starting to feel a lot worse. And he was getting bloated, was losing weight, he was losing his appetite, he was getting more fatigue, making us think something's going on. Now, one of the hints here, though, is that his PSA is not going up, okay? So it doesn't look like there's something about his androgen receptor that's being activated, but we were worried enough to do a scan. And when we did a scan, this is the liver, you can see that now he's got growing disease in the liver. So what's going on here? So one of the things that you will hear is that we at MSKCC do a lot of biopsies, and we do a lot of sequencing in order to figure out what are the mutations that are driving the disease, and what are mutations that are driving resistance, and whether we can target any of them. So this is the first biopsy, and I showed you a picture of prostate, normal prostate before. This was his prostate cancer. You can see it doesn't look that different. Still is a prostate. At that time, he had a mutation in a gene called P53 that you might know about. And then this was his liver biopsy, completely different, packed with cells. This is no longer like a prostate. In fact, this is it's very rapidly dividing. It looks what we call like a neuroendocrine cell. And now it's getting two more mutations. One is amplification of AR that probably happened earlier in order to reactivate AR when he was under ADT, and loss of another a new mutation in a gene called RB, one of the first tumor suppressors. Now, this set of P53RB makes us think that now he's growing, the tumor is growing faster. He might be sensitive to chemotherapy. And in fact, that is what is going on with him now. So, so what I talked to you about today, and I'll just talk to you a little bit about the interest in my lab. But this epigenetic landscape, normal tissue, normal cells, slowly gets differentiated and trapped into one landscape. And then when tumors develop, often they're still trapped in that landscape, and we can treat them with drugs that are specific for that lineage, that takes out the signaling for that lineage. As an example, for the Bruton's tyrosine kinase, and also against androgen receptor. How do you get resistance? This is not just for androgen receptor, but for everything. One of the most common ways you get resistance is by reactivating the receptor. And this is what we're learning all the time for every targeted therapy, so S for AR. Or how else do you get resistance? Well, as Craig said, how does a cell stay the way it is? How does it know not to change to a different type of cell? And there are a lot of factors involved, transcription factors, epigenetic factors. This is really the focus of my laboratory research. And as you treat tumors and really hammer at this lineage, the other way that they can escape is to go into other lineages. And that's the other major challenge into how to treat these people, is to how to prevent that from happening. So I think I really already talked to you about my summary. I'll just leave the summary slide here. You can read about it. But it was a great pleasure to talk to you. And
So questions for Dr. Chen. Somebody's got to be brave and be the first one. So you have to get up to the microphone. So come on up to the microphone so that the people in the other rooms can hear you. While we're waiting for people to come up, one of the things that Dr. Chen was just telling you about his research is that reverse fundamental question. If a cell's a prostate cell, how does it know not to be a cell from your eye? And one of the real excitements in biology now that you've learned about is our ability to reprogram cells through these things called transcription factors. It's a major thrust of research here at the Institute to understand how cell identity is maintained. Next question.
Okay, so according to the cellular composition that was modeled in this presentation, I noticed cells were clustered up closer in comparison to the composition of a normal prostate. Does the composition affect other organs and body systems and functions in males when not enough testosterone is produced by the adrenal glands?
So what happens, because you've blocked testosterone, what happens to males because they don't have it in the normal glands?
Right. So what happens to males when you block testosterone? What are the side effects?
If not enough testosterone is produced by the adrenal glands, I know it's going to affect the prostate. But now, along with affecting the prostate, does it also affect other body systems and functions within the body of a male?
Yes, yes. So that's a great question. This is something that I talk about, all the time with my patients. So the testosterone does a lot of things. It causes all the male characteristics. So when we give them therapy, we give them these side effects are exactly expected from if you were to take away testosterone. Actually, menopausal symptoms is the most common, but people can lose muscle mass. People take testosterone, gain muscle, they gain fat, they can have thinning of bones. So all the things that you think about of testosterone withdrawal, you can have those. Loss of libido, loss of erections. In fact, so these side effects over time can actually increase very slightly the risk of heart disease. And Craig talked about there are a lot of prostate cancers. Almost all of us, as the males, will get prostate cancer. A lot of prostate cancers will never kill you. It will not do anything to you. And there were these large trials in which everybody was detected with very low-risk prostate cancer got this therapy. And they, on average, actually lived shorter than the people who didn't get this therapy from heart attacks, diabetes.
Thank you.
So one of the things that we go last question here, but one of the things that patients have most as a side effect that you'll remember tonight, it's not the serious health problems, but when you don't have a male hormone, guys, our fat builds up all the places women have fat. And so we look a lot different. That's what patients get most upset about. Next question.
This is kind of a personal question. Like, what inspired you to work this research? Like, because I know many people have different reasons.
Mm-hmm.
Or sometimes people inspire them, or it's just like college.
Right. Right. As I was in high school, I was really into physics. I was building these circuits. And into college, too, I was doing that. And then I think, as Craig said, cancer is the thing that affects all of our lives. We'll all have things about cancer affects us. And I decided somewhere in junior year of college that this is the question of my generation, and this is what I wanted to work on. I always knew I wanted to be a scientist.
Two last questions, right here.
If the prostate cancer can only be contracted by a male, however, if certain diseases such as the congenital adrenal hyperplasia is contracted by a female, is it possible for the females to also develop certain aspects of the prostate cancer?
So females during development will not I do not know that question, congenital adrenal hyperplasia. I do not think they develop prostate, although I don't know that. That's a great question to look up.
So this is a stump the experts time.
Yes.
You guys win points every time you stump one of these guys. It's a really important question. There are people still answering it, and that is why you're here, to learn that we don't know the answer for everything in science. So thank you for the question.
Yes.
Let's move on to the next question.
I know that most prostate cancers occur in men over 50, so middle age to elderly men. But have you ever had a pediatric patient, or have you ever studied how common that is, and what are the differences between a rare pediatric case of prostate cancer versus it being much more common?
So the youngest prostate cancer patient I've had is about 40, but not pediatric. Now, from these autopsy series that Craig was talking about, there's about 40% chance that 40-year-old will have cancer that's seen, but not clinically relevant. So it is a little bit only of the older population, even people who are genetically predisposed. But just to let you know, everybody that you know is not breast cancer is different for people who think prostate. Breast cancer is very common in the 30s. It's the most common cancer in women in the 30s and 40s. But in prostates, by and large, 50s and older.
So it's another good question. The incidence of different cancers occurs in different age. Your classmates who have had cancer, and some of you unfortunately have been in classes where somebody got cancer, by and large, it's leukemia, lymphoma, or the bone cancers, or the brain cancers. It's not the breast, the colon, the prostate, the livers that your parents' generation is being affected. We do not know why that is. So it's a big fundamental question. Well, I want to thank Dr. Chen. We're going to move on. To Dr. Steve Long, who uses structural biology to understand how things pass through cells and how we use that information to communicate between cells. Steve.
All right. Thanks very much. And so this is actually going to be pretty different kind of talk. Because what we're trying to understand is really the molecular details of how proteins work, a couple different proteins. And these proteins are involved in a process known as calcium signaling, and the proteins themselves are ion channels. And so I'll be telling you about one of these channels and our efforts to try and understand how it works. So first, just some general properties about ion channels. So you probably know that cells are surrounded by a membrane, this lipid bilayer. And lipid and ions, and lipid and water, don't mix. You know, salad dressing stays separate. And so ions can't pass through the membrane on their own. They need something to allow them to pass through. And actually, our bodies use this process of ions moving in and out of cells to govern things like action potentials, to control the movement of our fingers, to allow us to think. And they also allow it to control processes, slow processes. So these ones I've mentioned are very fast, but they're also very slow processes, such as activation of gene transcription, which involves ion channels. And so the proteins ion channels, such as those depicted here, allow ions, such as calcium, potassium, sodium, or chloride, to go in and out of cells. And this allows the cells to do different things. And so these channels have three basic properties. One, they allow the ions to go through. It's this sort of a giant assembly. It's a giant machine to let this teeny little charged particle move through it. So they allow the ions to permeate. And then they typically are particularly selective. So a potassium channel is selective for potassium, and a calcium channel for calcium. The chloride channels, you can see that there's only one negatively charged species up here, only one anion. And so chloride channels tend to not be as selective as their cation counterparts. The channels also have a property known as gating, which is the opening and closing of the ion conduction pathway, sort of like turning on and off the spigot. And so we want to understand how these three basic properties work for a couple different ion channels and ones that are involved in calcium signaling. So what is calcium signaling? So across the plasma membrane, which is depicted here, so this represents the inside of the cell at the bottom and the outside of the cell at the top, across that membrane, there's about a 20,000-fold gradient of calcium. And this is established by pumps that remove calcium from the cytosol. So they require energy, and they pump calcium out of the cell. This generates a 20,000-fold gradient of calcium across the cell. And this is actually the largest gradient for any anion, for any ion that we have. And our bodies make use of this by the means of calcium channels. So a calcium channel will allow the influx of calcium under certain circumstances. And this can cause different things to happen. For example, in a T cell, when it's presented with an antigen-presenting cell that has an MHC molecule attached to it, it activates a series of pathways that opens calcium channels in the plasma membrane. And this is required for turning on the genes of these T cells to fight off the immune, to initiate their immune response. And that's depicted here, because these calcium ions might bind to a protein such as this, and they can go on and turn on other proteins, including gene transcription. The calcium ions can also go and bind to other proteins, and in this case, it's a channel, and this is a chloride channel. So this is a calcium-activated chloride channel. So my laboratory's main focus is on understanding these two different types of channels, the calcium channels themselves and the calcium-activated channels. And so I'll be telling you today a story about this calcium-activated chloride channel. So about 25 years or so ago, it was known that mutations in this protein, which is called bestrophin, that's the calcium activated chloride channel, mutations in this protein, which are depicted as red dots here on this three-dimensional structure, they cause eye disease. But it wasn't clear, it's still not clear why they cause eye disease. And in fact, the physiological role of this channel is actually not that well understood. We have four of these in our bodies, these calcium activated chloride channels called bestrophin 1 through bestrophin 4. And they seem to be involved in some level in sperm, but it's not clear what the physiological role is. And in fact, there's a lot of fundamental features of this channel that are not well understood. Even its basic property, is the channel a calcium-activated chloride channel? Because the studies that have been done previously were done in cells, and it's hard to identify and hard to prove that this is a calcium-activated chloride channel. But we thought it was. And so how does calcium cause the channel to open? What makes the channel selective for chloride? Why is it a chloride channel? Why does only chloride essentially go through the pore? And so we wanted to understand these questions. And we do so from both a functional, doing functional experiments, maybe testing things, making mutations, and also from a structural perspective. So if we can come up with what this thing looks like, it's almost like if you'd never seen a car before, but if you could get a picture of a car, you might be able to do an experiment to pop a tire and then ask, you know, what does that do? And so we want to use structure and function to investigate that. So just a note about protein structure. So as you know, proteins are an assembly of amino acids, essentially beads on a string. You have 20 different amino acids and they're connected in some sequence. And so it's, when you think about it, it just blows my mind every time. I'm getting goosebumps now thinking about it, which is that the protein itself, the amino acid sequence, is the blueprints. It's the assembly instructions for that eventual machine that's going to come out at the end, right? But it's also the raw materials. It itself is the building blocks. The protein, which is the information, is also the building blocks for the machine it's going to make. And in many cases, these proteins are often self-assembling. So it's as if you took a box of car parts, all the parts in a car, the thousands of parts, and you shook it up, and then out popped a car with no extra parts. That's in a way what a protein is. And we don't actually understand the rules for what going from this amino acid sequence to its three-dimensional structure. We don't understand these rules. These rules do exist because, as I explained, all the information is there. But we can't yet figure out what this is for the most part. Now, there are some incredible inroads into this. But for the most part, for complex proteins, we don't understand what they are until we look at them, until we see them in three dimensions. And so we want to do that. We want to see them in three dimensions and then to understand how these proteins function. So a note on how we study their function. Because the protein we're studying is an ion channel, for example, a chloride ion channel, because the chloride molecule is a charged molecule, when it moves, it carries a current, you know, from physics. And so imagine this experimental setup where we have two chambers and we fill them with potassium chloride solutions. And then between them is a small opening. And into that opening, we put a membrane. We paint a little membrane. And then we purify the protein, this is the ion channel, and we stick it into this membrane. And then we study it using electrical currents. We study it using the electrical currents that are carried by the ions as they move from one chamber to the next using a voltmeter and an ammeter, very simple type of setup. And so from that, we can study the ion channel. So for example, if we're studying bestrophin, this one that I mentioned, in the presence of calcium, you see that you get, this is on a current versus voltage relationship, and you remember V equals IR from physics, that voltage and current are related to one another. So in the presence of calcium, you see that you get an almost linear relationship. That means that the chloride ions are flowing through the channel when calcium is present. But when you remove the calcium, you can see that the channel closes. The channel actually shuts closed. And so this proves that this protein, bestrophin, is in fact a calcium-activated chloride channel because we've purified it and we've studied it in that way. So how do we then determine structure? We have two basic methods that we use to determine protein structure. One is shown on the left and one is shown on the right. So with X-ray crystallography, we actually form a crystal of the protein. And this contains about 10 to the 12th molecules of the channel, so a lot of molecules, 10 to the 12th. And then we go and we use something called the synchrotron, which is this giant thing. It's about a kilometer in diameter. And the electrons go flying around in a circle. And when an electric charge particle accelerates, it emits a photon. We use those X-rays that come off. We shoot it at the crystal. And then we get a diffraction pattern. And that diffraction pattern gives us information about the protein. So put that on the side for just a second, and then we use another technique, electron microscopy, which is essentially a very simple concept. You just put the protein onto a little sample here. You stick it in this fancy electron microscope, which is being installed right across the hall. I'm very excited we're getting this very one, which is an incredible thing. Thank you, Craig. And then from that, we take a picture. We essentially look at that. We look at that protein. And then you can see each one of these little proteins here. And so this only requires about 100,000 samples. We only have to look at the protein about 100,000 times. So we require much less information, actually. But the output of both of those techniques is something like this. This is the electron cloud, the cloud of electrons that surrounds and makes up that protein. And so this gives us its shape. And into this cloud of electrons, which we observe, and we put on 3D glasses, and we thank you to all the gamers because we get nice cheap 3D glasses these days. And we put those on, and we can then build into that an atomic model, a representation of that protein. And so this protein that I've been showing you, this is, in fact, the calcium-activated chloride channel bestrophin. And this is it viewed from the extracellular side, so as if we were outside the cell looking down on it. And what we did to actually get it to crystallize is we made these antibodies, and that was sort of a little trick that we did to get it to crystallize. And you can see that it has a hole right down the middle, and that there are five parts. I've colored them accordingly. And so there are five identical copies of this gene. And in fact, we didn't know how many copies there were that made up this ion channel until we saw it, using this technique. And so we'll rotate it down now, look at it from the side. And so this is the approximate boundaries of the membrane. So this is the membrane here. And you can see that the channel extends into the cytosol quite a ways here. And it has a pretty complex structure. Each subunit has this type of architecture. And we identified several different parts of the ion channel, which I'll show in just a moment. So what I'll do is take a sort of a slice down the middle from the top to the bottom, and then just look at a couple, three of the subunits, and then draw the pathway. This is the ion pathway. This is the pore along which the ions will flow. And you can see that it has lots of features to it. So if an ion were moving from, a chloride ion would be moving from the inside of the cell out, which is the general direction that these chloride ions would flow, it would pass through this aperture, it would pass through this thing that we call a neck, and then eventually emerge in the outside. So some questions we wanted to ask are, where is the calcium sensor that governs whether this thing is open or closed? As I showed you before, when calcium is present, the channel is open. When calcium is removed, the channel is closed. So where is the sensor that causes that to happen? And where is the gate? Where is the part of the channel that squeezes shut the ion conduction pathway to prevent the flow of chloride ions? Again, how does ion permeation occur? And then why is this channel selective? Why do chloride ions typically go through the channel and not sodium ions? What makes it so? And so now that we had the structure, we wanted to ask some of these basic questions. And so we're looking at the function of the neck. So the neck is this little narrow section here in this part of the channel. And as I showed you before, with and without calcium, there's a big effect. Well, we thought, well, what if we do an experiment? And what if we mutate these amino acids that line the neck? And we actually determined the structure of this mutant. We mutated them to alanine just simply by changing their DNA and then asking the yeast to make it for us, which they did very happily. And then study this in the same kind of assay. And what you see is that this thing no longer responds to calcium. It doesn't care if calcium is bound or not. And so from that and some other experiments, we identified that the neck is the gate. The neck is the part of the channel that allows the chloride ions to either go through or to not go through the channel. And that does so in a calcium-dependent manner. And so this is actually all unpublished work that was done by George Fazy in the laboratory. So then also, we also identified this calcium binding site that we call a calcium clasp. And this is a calcium ion. We wanted to understand, is this the calcium sensor? And in fact, it turns out to be the calcium sensor. I won't go through all the data on that. But the calcium clasp is the calcium sensor that governs the neck. So somehow, this calcium clasp is connected to the neck, which is about right here. OK, so what about this aperture? What about this section of the pore here? It really puzzled me as to what this thing might be doing. But then we did a similar kind of experiment just by, well, first let me set up the experiment. So investigating the function of the aperture. So before, when we looked at this setup, we had chloride ions on both sides, potassium chloride on both sides. I just removed the potassium for clarity. So, but now what we're going to do is we're going to stick acetate, this larger molecule, on one side, and we'll stick chloride on the other side. So if we have our channel, in the membrane. The chloride will be allowed to go from right to left, but it turns out that this channel is not permeable to acetate, so acetate can't go through. So there's no permeation of acetate in this direction. And so if you do your IV curve, your voltage versus current, your current versus voltage relationship, what you see is that you get at negative voltages, you get chloride flow. So chloride ions are flowing through the pore. But that at positive voltages, you don't remember how it used to go straight? It doesn't go straight anymore, and it asymptotes to zero, essentially. And so that means that acetate does not flow through the channel. OK, so what happens if we then take this aperture and we mutate this amino acid, which lines the aperture, to alanine? So we did that. And what we find is that mutant actually allows acetate to flow through the pore. So just making that single mutation allows this larger molecule to flow through the pore. And so what this tells us is that the aperture is a size-selective filter. It only lets small things go through. It doesn't let large things go through. And that, we think, has an important, probably has an important physiological function. So finally, why is the channel selective for chloride over anions, over cations, over sodium? And this is, in fact, we think, due to the binding of chloride ions in the, on the ion conduction pathway. There are actually 15 of these anions on the ion conduction pathway. So then to summarize, bestrophin is a calcium-activated chloride channel. And we've identified the neck and the aperture, that the neck is the gate to which the calcium sensor acts on. It acts on that. The aperture is a size-selective filter. And we think that that prevents the macromolecules from either plugging the pore or flowing through the channel. And of course, this, this work is slightly, this is another story we're trying to understand an enzyme called ICMT, which methylates RAS and potentially is a good cancer target. But none of this would be out without, none of this we could have done without a wonderful team. So I thank them and I thank you for your attention.
We're good for two questions if people have it. To put this in some molecular detail, the most common drugs used to help patients in the world are things that open and close channels, but we need to know their properties. Almost all heart medicines, all blood pressure medicines, take advantage of this information to do that. We believe it'll be true in cancer as well. Any specific questions? Come to the microphone. And then we'll go on with our third speaker. All the speakers will be available at the end for anybody that has a specific question and feels too shy to do it. We'll have this one question, then we'll go on to the next speaker.
Wouldn't the molecular molecular selectivity gate also act as a size selectivity gate? Wouldn't like that potentially be able to have one gate fill two purposes? Or am I misunderstanding how things work at a smaller scale?
No, that's a great question. So this channel turns out to be very different than every other type of ion channel that we've studied, that people have studied so far. Because it's sort of, now oftentimes the gate is separate from the part that's selective. But you're right in the sense that they look kind of similar. And so why is the gate, I don't know, it's an interesting feature. We don't really understand this. And part of that relates to, it relates to what we're doing now, is to try and understand. I mentioned that if you mutate the aperture, that acetate can flow through. But it doesn't look like acetate should be able to fit through the neck, right? So why is that? So we think actually there's another conformation of the neck that we haven't observed yet, which is wider. But we're trying to figure that out.
Thank you, Steve. So our last speaker is Dr. Papamanuel. And she studies using mathematical approaches and our ability to sequence the human genome, the complexity in cancer. And from that complexity, to learn simple explanations for why certain cancers have certain mutations and others do not. Ellie.
Thank you so much. It's a real pleasure to be here today. I'm not sure if you can hear me. Is the microphone working? Okay. So it's a real pleasure to be here and present some of the work that our field and the data that our field is generating and the approaches we take to understand a little bit more about cancer. So when I was at school and about your age, there was one topic that just really captured my attention, and that was DNA. And one of the reasons that I'm here today is because cancer is indeed a disease of the DNA. So we know that the human genome is now about 3 billion base pairs, and just a tiny fraction of that genome encodes for protein genes, and that's about 1.5%. And there are estimates that can range, depending on the study, that approximately another 10 or 15% can be functional in the terms that they can encode for regions in the genome, that they can regulate these 20,000 genes or organize a chromosomal function. So cancer arises when mutations occur, and on a daily basis, we've heard we have trillions of cells, and each cell has 3 billion base pairs, and any of those base pairs can get mutated. However, luckily, when those mutations fall in the genome, the probability is that they will fall in parts of the genome that they will not have a direct consequence in the way the cell that carries those mutations regulates itself. Occasionally, a mutation may fall within one of the regulatory or functional genome, and very, very rarely, they will fall in one of the 19 or 20,000 genes. Again, luckily, many of those mutations may not have any consequence at all. And it's very rare that one of those mutations are going to change the way that that cell regulates the way it replicates or it controls DNA damage, and it will result in uncontrolled proliferation and what we recognize at the moment as cancer. So if we were to think about it in a simplistic model, there we have a cell that has acquired one mutation, and that transforms the cell. It gives it some different properties. Studies from the early studies of cancer postulated that, in fact, cancer, mutation acquisition in cancer, follows a model of Darwinian evolution, which I'm sure many of you have heard about, in which one mutation is going to confer a selective advantage into the cell that carries it. But in actual fact, it takes a number of mutations to come together, conferring distinct properties in each cell. And those not only develop genetic diversity, but also some cells with a specific repertoire of mutations will have distinct advantages over other cells within their microenvironment. And in fact, early epidemiological studies, we heard today that generally, the older you get, the more cancer you get. So early epidemiological studies, and these are from the 1950s, took the age of patients across the most common cancers and a number of different countries around the world, and the incidence in which cancer arose. So postulating that DNA mutations cause cancer and looking at these age incidence curves, there was an estimate that cancer is not the consequence of one mutation, but in fact, it's the consequence of 6 to 7 successive mutations coordinating to transform a cell and ultimately develop the cancer in which a patient has presented with. So how do we today study cancer genomes? Cancer genome studies and the way we perform them today would have not been possible if we didn't have the reference genome. And it really took an enormous amount of money, coordination, collaboration, and years to develop the reference cancer genome. So from 1990 to 2003, institutions around the world put together their joint efforts to try and understand the end-to-end sequence of those 3 billion base pairs. In more recent years, with the reference genome and with the development of what we call next-generation sequencing technologies, it is now possible to take a genome and sequence it with $3,000 within 3 days and perhaps analyze it within 7 days. And that really enables us to deliver a catalog of acquired mutations in cancer. So how do we do that? What we usually do is when a patient presents into our hospital, there is a cancer sample obtained or a biopsy, those cells are taken and DNA is extracted. We also take a reference sample, in this case, a blood sample, where we extract the DNA to get a representation of the genomic sequence we've inherited from our mom and our dad. Then both those DNA molecules are sequenced, and we get the reference genome for that patient, and then a sequence of the cancer genome from that patient. And we can very readily identify where a base pair can be different from the reference base. So if you were to show you a real example of how would that look, this is a patient, a neuroblastoma patient from Memorial, for which we've sequenced the DNA, and we have the reference sequence here. Every dot represents a perfect match with both the germline DNA as well as the reference DNA, and here we see a G2A mutation. And clearly, we don't use screenshots to analyze cancer genomes. There's been a lot of effort where algorithms have been developed that scroll through those 3 billion base pairs and try and identify mismatches were maybe present specific to the tumor cell. And this produced summarized results that we then evaluate to try and identify which are the mutations that actually cause cancer. And this is important because every cancer genome can have anywhere from 1,000 to 10,000 mutations. So which one of those mutations have actually conferred the property on that cell to proliferate and expand uncontrollably? To answer this question, in the past 10 years, international consortia have come together, both with the Cancer Genome Atlas and the International Cancer Genome Consortium that I was part of when I trained in the UK. And what those consortia did is they took 300 or 500 representative cancer samples from each cancer type and sequenced the genome to try and identify the most relevant or important mutations within each cancer type. And that very much produced a very detailed catalog of the most recurrent or acquired mutations in cancer. And what they showed was that it was approximately 500 genes, or of those 20,000 genes and the thousands of mutations that were analyzed, there were only 500 genes in which recurrent mutations were identified amongst all the cancer types. And this very much provides a blueprint for cancer biology. For every gene that is identified, there is a new mechanism or a new pathway or a new protein that perhaps we never thought before this effort started that is directly linked to cancer biology. I was privileged enough to be part of this effort for leukemias and pediatric cancers, and I distinctly remember that every time a new gene was discovered in the UK, the BBC would come and we would have a press conference and we would discuss about the new gene and how frequent it was in a tumor type, the new biology that it uncovered. And at the end of every press conference, we would be asked to say, and this is going to lead to new treatments and this is how we're going to cure this disease. And it was always felt a little bit agonizing to say that, because that very much delivered a promise. And it delivered an expectation to the public that we, now that we have this catalog of acquired mutations, it's a very relatively easy task to go take these mutations and deliver the treatments. And there are examples in which this has succeeded, and this has very much delivered the promise of what we call personally tailored or precision medicine, where a patient is going to walk into a hospital, such as our hospital. They can get sequenced for one of those important 500 cancer genes. We're going to identify a mutation in gene A, B, or C, and then very soon we're going to have the perfect treatment for gene A, B, and C. And though we have seen some notable successes that very much speak to this paradigm, an example is the discovery of the BRAF mutations, which happened early in 2002. Though they're prevalent in a number of cancers, they're particularly important in skin cancer or melanoma, where the current treatment options that are predominantly based by chemotherapy or radiotherapy really do not have high response rates. And in 2011, there was a drug that was very specific to the mutations that we found in BRAF gene and showed very high initial response. And some of you may have seen that, but these are patients before they received this drug that had BRAF mutations, and these are the PET scans from the very same patients immediately, or as little as 2 weeks after receiving that treatment, quite a lot of that disease had melted away. And this is what triggered this promise of precision medicine. However, sadly and unfortunately, for most of those patients, the disease returned, and then that treatment was no more effective. So I previously showed how we picture the phylogenetic tree, or the natural history of any tumor type. And if we were to postulate that in those particular patients, mutation B was the mutation in the BRAF gene, which very much conferred not only selective advantage, but dominated that disease, upon inhibition of a targeted therapy, what sequencing of sequential samples of the disease progression or relapse showed was that there were often other cells that had a different repertoire of mutations that could then take over. So after we finish our press conferences and we've discovered the genes and we've delivered the promise, I also very often find myself in either social gatherings or taxis most frequently when someone is going to ask me, so what do you do? And I'm saying, I'm a cancer biologist, and what do you do? I'm doing genetics. And then pretty much always the question comes, but you've discovered all those genes. When are you going to treat this? When are you going to cure this? Are we ever going to find the cure for cancer? So in the introduction today, we heard that cancer is not a single disease. And indeed, we don't even know that it's in fact hundreds of diseases. It might even be thousands of diseases. Because if we think that the majority of cancers have 5 to 7 mutations in cancer genes, there are 500 possible cancer genes, the combinations immediately scale up into the thousands, if not 100,000s. So if we were to treat one of these particular gene mutations, does it matter whether it's an early event or a late event, or should we be thinking on how to rationalize combination therapy treatments where we can target both gene A or C, or understand what the downstream biology, what is the consequence of those mutations at the patient's cell? So my research very much uses these questions to try and understand a little bit more about how gene mutations come together to define cancer or distinct cancer subtypes. Our research interest is very much focused in leukemia as well as pediatric tumors. And we know that not only there are 500 genes, but the majority of them are very infrequently mutated. So a gene that's mutated in 2% of a cancer population, if I want to understand what the clinical correlations of that gene are, I really need thousands of patients to start to put together how this gene defines the wiring of the cancer cell. So the way we approach this is we start with population profiling studies. So we sequence those cancer genes in large population cohorts. This is an example of a very recent study that we've completed in 1,500 or so AML patients. We uncovered 5,234 mutations. Most of them are infrequent. Of those 1,540 patients, what's important to know is that there were 1,060 unique genotypes. So in the same way that each one of you is unique, the cancer of every patient is unique. But knowing that every leukemia has 2 or 3 mutations, we asked, do these genes come together more frequently than you would expect by chance? So we asked, are there significant patterns of commutation? And here I just want you to see the enrichment of the plots, nothing else. The X and the Y axis have each one of the genes that are mutated in this particular type of leukemia. And the blue tile indicates when 2 mutations come together more frequently than you would expect by chance. The brown tile indicates when 2 genes are almost never mutated together. And that's a pattern of mutual exclusivity. So if we were to study the 300 or 500 cases, which is what most of the cancer discovery studies say, we see some patterns of commutation. But as we subsample to 600, 900, 1200, and 500 cases, we start seeing that actually the way that gene mutations come together to define leukemia can be quite specific. And in fact, not only do the way that gene mutations come together is specific, but also the order in which they come together can be highly recurrent within the patients. And what this gave me was hope, because although we have 1,060 unique genotypes, we have 11 common themes. We identify 11 molecular subgroups. Here you see the patients in every row and the mutations that define each group. What's most important is that each group is defined by these very specific early, secondary, and late mutations. So now we can take this knowledge from the population, identify distinct groups that perhaps are high-risk groups or associate with low response to therapy. We can select patients and obtain samples from those patients, and we can start to study the very specific genetic interactions in the way they appear in cancer patients. We can rationalize therapies. We can build experimental models that render information from population studies. And we know that the information we deliver here is directly informed from the patient samples and very much represents the way that leukemia develops, the natural history of the disease, can help us start addressing many of those questions. So from a clinical perspective, this can help us provide a knowledge bank or a reference basis that we can then learn clinical correlations from the large population cohorts. And when a patient walks into MSK, we sequence them, we identify the mutation combination, and then we can have more informed choices, both in terms of what treatment decisions we need to take, but also understand that biology a little bit better. In the last couple of minutes, I would like to switch a little bit gear and go a step back as to another insight and very important insight on what else we can learn from cancer genome studies. So we've talked a lot about the genes and the order in the genes and what we can understand from a particular gene in terms of the biology and how we can treat this to both diagnose or treat a patient better. But the genome and the cancer genome is in many ways a footprint of all the mutation processes that have happened in that particular cell throughout the patient's lifetime. And if one was to look at the statistics of the cancer types that appear across the globe, one can see that very different cancers can appear in the Western world as opposed to Australia or Africa and Southeast Asia. And this is very much testament to the exposures that populations or the habits that distinct populations have. So, for example, in Australia, one of the most frequent cancers is melanoma. We know that there's very significant UV exposure there. And in fact, if we were to look at the cancer genome of any melanoma patient, we know that the mutation patterns that melanoma has is very much related to sun exposure. Likewise, if we were to look at tobacco smokers, the genome very much has a mutation pattern that's specific to tobacco exposure. If you were to give me two genomes, I would be able to tell you who smoked and who sunbathed and whether the genome was derived from a lung cancer patient or whether it derived from a melanoma patient. Aging is one of the most fundamental processes, and here we show that just by increasing patient age, the number of mutations increase. And by having now sequenced thousands of cancer genomes, we can start asking those questions in regards to the patterns of the mutations that we see and learn a little bit more about the mechanisms that cause those mutations. For sure, aging is the most pronounced, smoking, but we can now recognize patients that have cancers that have developed from mutations that were a consequence of DNA repair errors, DNA replication errors, UV exposure, or exposure to other agents. And we can look at unknown patterns to try and understand new mechanisms. And in the context of leukemia, we very recently had a study where we identified a very specific mutation pattern that represented the majority of the mutations found in a cohort of 60 kids with acute lymphoblastic leukemia. We were able to statistically model the patterns of mutation acquisition and identify the protein that is linked to these patterns. And then using single-cell genomics, we were able to identify that this protein did not cause these mutations at one point in time, but created both the early and the late events in the phylogenies of those tumors. So in summary, when one looks down a cancer genome, not only can we identify the mutations that genome is defined by, but we can understand a lot about what has happened to that patient, the exposures that led to the mutation acquisition, that led to the mutations that caused those patients cancer. We can identify which are the gene mutations that we need to think at the hospital in terms of diagnosis and how these mutations can inform disease biology and how we can now perform research into novel therapies and disease monitoring. And this takes a combination of skills from experimental biology to medicine to programming and statistics. So science is becoming more and more interdisciplinary, and there is no better place I found to perform science like that as Memorial Sloan Kettering. So thank you very much for your attention.
So thank you, Ellie, for a tremendous glimpse into what big data is going to give us in terms of glimpse into human biology. I think in the interest of time, since we've reached the end of the time allotted, all three of the speakers will be down here to answer any specific questions that people have, but I know some of the buses and some of the rides have to get home. I thank you all for participating.
take information on our high school programs at the outside.